Hi, everybody. I'm here with Mr. Holman, who's so awesomely going to share a little bit about his digital history textbook project that we here at Wikispaces found on Twitter. And I think you'll be really inspired. So, Mr. Holman, do you want to share with us what you do, how this project came about, and how you used Wikispaces to design this awesome textbook?
Well, first, the textbook started about 8 years ago. So this has been a massive project over 8 years with about 1,600 students at two school districts that we team teach via the web every day. So we've, over the course of these 7 to 8 years, we've built a living textbook that changes every year. It's all student created. There is no adult creation in here, with the exception of a couple videos that are in here from Amy Burwell, who's in Hawaii, who does some pretty interesting parody songs that the kids really got into, and we have copies of that. So the textbook itself is built between my school district. I teach at Beechwood City Schools outside of Cleveland, Ohio, and then Mike Pennington is my cohort in crime, who is currently is working at Chardon Local Schools, which is about 45 miles east of here. So each day we'd have a meetings IO going and Skype going, and the kids know each other and they work with each other, and we'll kind of walk through some of the actual book itself and explain how it came to be. Does that sound good?
Awesome.
So I guess the first thing, we're on the homepage. I think you can see that. The whole concept is this is students' legacy. So we spend a lot of time about legacy and how do kids build legacy and build the capacity to do great things is what we're trying to get kids to do. Mike and I talk a lot about we're not trying to motivate kids. We're trying to inspire kids to be something totally different than they were when they came into the classroom. So as I start here, there's an intro movie that I have to say takes a little while to explain because it's all spliced up with about 50 kids being involved in answering a variety of questions about the book. And a lot of people don't get that, but that's the concept of the wiki, that through the democratization of everybody being involved, we come up with the best possible answers that we can get. So it's also been used at TED Talks. So this has been getting a little national and international press. Alan November wrote his last book, Who Owns the Learning, and his last two chapters deal with this online textbook and how the kids are building it. And William Kist, who's here in Ohio, wrote a book called The Global School that talks quite a bit about how kids are using this. So we kind of go through another cool one. We were interviewed in LA, and so the kids are in LA, and this is Ashton Kutcher's production company. So he tweeted it out, went out to 7.2 million people or some such thing, which was pretty cool. And so a variety of things here. I'll show you some. Well, we'll go through a little bit of this. To the left, we have our table of contents. Now, when this started, we just took our standards and created the topics we had to address. And it became 8 years ago, it was an end of the year project. We said, what are you most interested in? What did you like learning about the most? And so at the end of the first year, the kids had created basically an outline, three or four paragraphs of like the topic. And Mr. Pennington and I were so excited, we went to Disney World. Now, we really did that with our respective families, but we were really excited about this book until we looked at it after the summer was over, and we're like, it's just a bunch of text on paper. So the kids weren't so excited the next year when they saw this, and they started to talk about links and what could we do to make it more interactive. Now, if you go back 7 years ago, that's pretty unique to be talking about in public schools. So anyways, as the year progressed, what you're looking at now is the compilation of these 1,600 kids over 7 years. So there's a lot more to this than if we go into the history, you'll begin to see. One of my favorite pages is probably the Renaissance page. And the purpose for this one being so interesting to me is this image or this movie here was created by a 12-year-old 2 years ago, and it has a little over 65,000 views on YouTube. So as a freshman in high school, he's got 65,000 people that have seen his work. We are changing what it means to have students do work. No longer do they give me an essay and I take it, throw it, or I give them a grade and they put it either in the trash, which is where the majority put it, or worse, they put it in their notebook, which they never see again. We're trying to get everything published to the web. So I got a kid that in 2 years, when he starts to think about a college, he can talk about it. It's fantastic. It's like PBS quality. Everything you look down through has then been Creative Commons links. So we're teaching the kids ethics. So everything is back to the Creative Commons. So they're using correct licensing as they build their book. There might be some pages where you don't see that. Originally, we didn't start that way. So kids have gone in and continually changed it to make it more ethically correct than what we should be using. I got to slide down here a little bit to get back to the book. Each book then has the written text as they see fit, and it changes every year. So if we learn something new, or if we decide that a fact isn't written well, or the information needs to change, then that will be pulled out. There's also PowerPoints on here, and you can see a variety of the conclusion. They're building thing links now, so they're adding imagery that comes alive. And then they try to leave their name of when they edited what they did and how they proceeded. Each page runs off this left, so we just continually keep adding new things. If we go to another page, the Black Death, now you're seeing some Wordles that are created by about 400 kids. We got some music videos in there. Can I play a little piece of this? This is my favorite
Yeah, oh
one.
my gosh,
Do you
let's
mind?
see it.
So the kids really copied this Amy Burwell, who's become a little hero to these kids. And so they started writing their own musical parodies. This is by far my favorite. So we'll just play a clip of it so you can get a sense of them. I hope my volume works. And I hope it plays.
Looks like it's loaded. Let's give it a go. There we go. Fun.
The models came down the road carrying Black Death with a cold. I tried to run and escape. I don't want to die. The Silk Road is for trade. Gold and silver were made. This isn't what I wanted. I don't want to die. The bodies were cardboard. Smells and blood showing. Take down the book going. Do the check for how the baby is.
I think you get it. It's just a catchy, fun thing. But the reality, the history inside that is absolutely perfect. They got it all down.
Oh,
even moving down a little more, now we get something much more interesting with the kids. No, I shouldn't say more interesting. But in this case, I had a couple kids who read a little bit of the Decameron, and they wanted to find out some more. Well, I'm not an expert in 13th or 14th century Italian literature. But we found someone at UC Davis who was. So this is an interview that they interviewed. A professor from UC Davis has written two books on the Black Death and women's role in the Middle Ages. They did an interview via Skype. Now, this was about an hour and 20 minutes that they cut down by themselves to 14 minutes, where they interviewed her about the questions. So now the kids are building the content, like truly building all the content you're seeing on this page. Again, I'm really sorry about the loading. It seems to take forever, but they typically don't do this. I'll just see if I can skip ahead.
Oh, cool.
So you can kind of see a little bit where they're using Skype to interact with experts all over the world. Now, we've also talked with people from, Ghana, West Africa, Stockholm, Sweden. So we're connecting with people all over the world to try to do these things. Again, all the images are Creative Commons. All the text is kid created. And they basically are just explaining the entire process of what our textbook would normally cover, only now we are having kids write it in kid language for kids.
Cool.
We got some political cartoons in here. So you got kids that are artists that are building cartooning, and they proceed to go through it.
Can you click
even
on
last
the,
year, the kids wanted to add some...
Oh, sorry.
Sorry, were you asking a question? Or...
Yeah, I was wondering if you could show their... show their editing, like on the revision history. Could you show the kind of how many the kids have been changing and making differences?
If we look into this, the first thing is you see a lot of these are happening on maybe the last couple days of the year. But as you go down through it, depends. These pages, since they've been established and built, you're seeing pages in May and March. And, you know,
ooh,
if we can continue to go back, let me see if how far back I can get here. So now we're back 2-3 years ago. So we'll click on this page and see what it looked like to see what it was at that point. So this was the page 2 years ago. So as we kind of scroll down, you'll notice these are not Creative Commons images. So there's where that transition took place of now let's use it. And you can see the whole page. So if we go back to the original version, if I can click there without screwing it all up, which I will. Where do I click to go right back to the main version?
I think you can just go back button. It should take you back.
Oh, I just need to.
I think, yeah.
Yeah, I was going to. Yeah. I'll just click the Renaissance.
Yeah.
So that's the page. We got a good view of that. And then this is the page today. So over 5 years or 2 years, how they've changed it.
It's interesting to see the media change, too. A lot more videos, you know, thing links. So it's interesting to document how media has changed for kids, too. That's great.
It's very much that way. No matter what page we go to, you're going to see if you go back in the history and look at the edits, what is in there has changed. Predominantly, it's going to all Creative Commons. That was a big issue we had with the kids, was getting them to understand that they can't just take things off Google and use whatever they want.
Mm-hmm.
We did have some issues. I would point out on some of these, like this particular movie, The West Africa, it was blocked by YouTube. I was presenting in Boston about this book at an international conference, and we went to this page, and I was going to talk about it, and it was blocked. Kind of not what I wanted when I'm presenting, but it became a great teachable moment. We're like, well, you know, here's a kid's work on YouTube, and he did splice and sample from other works. It was blocked because that was in the middle of July. I came back to school, and the kid was now an eighth grader, not my class, and I called him in. He wrote a rebuttal on YouTube to it. Within an hour, they had it turned back on.
Oh,
he talked about
gosh.
Fair use and educational purposes and that this is a nonprofit book being used to teach other people, and they had it open within an hour. So my kids are becoming their own advocates really about other things as well, reaching way beyond, like, do you know the content of what we're trying to teach, which I think is the ultimate goal we're trying to get here. This really isn't about social studies content. It's about becoming an independent learner who can create amazing things for other people to learn from. And like I said, this year, you know, the pages just continue to change. We have kids that are working in the summer. So if you actually go in and start looking at all the pages, which our table of contents only shows about 20 pages, I think there's about 350 pages here. It's just we've picked. And so some of these links take you to other pages that kids like just wanted to do because they were interested. I'll show you one in particular that I found interesting. we were doing the Reformation, and a student, you can see it somewhere in here, he's like, well, there's not enough information about Martin Luther's life, and so I want to build a page on it. So when you click here, this is going to pull up this page on Martin Luther's life. And he found the Reformation Polka, which is not a student-created video, but it's pretty funny if you haven't seen it. And then he wrote this whole synopsis about Martin Luther's life and what it was like and all this stuff. Now, I know this is recorded, and I hope he never hears this, but I knew for a fact when he wrote this, nobody's ever going to read it. So none of my students are ever going to click to find out about his early life. But the point was, he had the desire to do this, and he went out and did the research. And I do have to add one more thing that I don't think I mentioned. Nothing you see has been graded on this book. I do absolutely no grades or no credit for this. So this is all intrinsic for the concept of leaving a legacy for other people to follow, other people to learn from. So what you begin to see is, as you saw a movie appear, then the next year's kids are like, wait a sec, I could build a movie that might make it on the book that thousands of people could potentially see. So it changes the whole, I guess, the elements of what we're trying to accomplish. It's not about grades, it's about what are you learning?
Mm-hmm.
And this technology makes that possible, and it keeps that history. So the Wikispace has been my choice all along. We actually started this on Wikibooks and made it about 6 weeks, and it was too difficult to do the HTML, and we forgot our password, so that became a problem. So we ended up going to Wikispaces again, I think 7 years ago. And I really just like it's a kid's playground is the way I describe it. You know, I have my own website, I have my own stuff, but this is where my kids build and create and share their knowledge with the world.
Oh, cool.
And so, I mean, if you go through it, there's just so much here. But last year, the kids really, we spend a lot of time at the beginning here, and I think it's relevant, where we talk a lot about digital footprints and what it means to leave digital footprints. So giving kids the concept of what does digital citizenship mean in the world that they're going to grow up in. You know, Dan Pink talks a lot about, you know, we're preparing kids for their future, not our past. And when I was in high school, I didn't have to worry about this stuff popping up 10 years down the road, but this stuff will for them. Mm-hmm. They can go to an interview and they can say, check out this documentary I made 8 years ago that 70,000 people have watched. Totally changes what they're able to do and what they're able to produce. But in this case, they built this page last year. It was two groups of kids, what we would call battling it out. So they put two perspectives up. Now, as we progress this year, sorry about that.
Oh, a wiki battle. I love that idea. Oh my gosh. That's such a good idea for taking the debate and kind of turning it on its head.
Right. So they'll have this perspective. So this year, as the kids move into class, they'll begin to modify or pick or decide or to change this to where hopefully by the end of the year, there's really only one perspective. Now, where this really gets interesting is when we started this, we had a 10-year plan, which most teachers don't typically think in 10 years. But we were thinking about a 10-year plan and where we could go. So our ultimate goal, and we think we have the connection made finally this year, is to make an identical copy from the European perspective, from a European school, that these two books would then be linked to see, here's what Americans, how we perceive this ancient history of Europe versus people who walk by these castles and live by this and see it every day, how's their perception different? The music's going to play, so if you want to hang on a minute, do you want to pause for a second? Okay. Directions of how to get to the site. This is usually the first time they've looked at it. I have them peruse the site, note some things that they like, things they would like to see different. And then we ask them to join. So all the kids join on one day. So I have open enrollment just that one day where you can just click and join. And in that case, that is set. And then I go back to my settings. Sorry about the interruption. And I go back into the settings and make it private again. Then if a kid comes late to school or not late, but let's say a student moves into the district, then they would just join through the normal membership thing, create the account. We use the same account for everything we create. So we use their school email, which is, you know, first initial, last name. And then we use their lunch code, which is a great way for other people to use because they don't forget how to get food. So we use their lunch code to get them to log in. So it's always the same. So no matter where they go, they know this is what I use to log in. So once they join, if they were to join that way, then I obviously get the email that says there are people waiting to join. I would sign them in. But the easiest way, I think, is to make it public. Give them a day, they all join, it's over and done with. And then even if not every single kid uses it, they've created the account. And if you have a way set up to get the kids to use the same account, then you don't have this worry about, well, I don't know my password and nobody knows what it is and we have to create a new account. It does make sense to come up with some of that pre-planning of use this all the time, use this. And another thing we did, which I think might be helpful to a lot of people out there, is if the username is the same, because that happens a lot, we add the area code that we live in. And that way I can say, well, add your area code. And that I really don't have kids that can't get logged in. They are able to put their normal Gmail and then add the area code. And if they can't, that's what I recommend. And they're always able to get in. We've never had any problems with that. So it might be two ways to kind of help organize and get your kids signed up and logged in. And once they are, you know, there's tutorials that you guys have made that kind of give an overview. I build tutorials specifically for my site about Creative Commons. So the kids have access to tutorials that they can watch and then go build on their own. And like I said, kids do it over the summer. Kids do it in the middle of the night. It's pretty interesting when they do it.
Awesome, Garth. So I love the open enrollment ID and then kind of getting naming conventions that make life easier for you guys as teachers. Thank you so much for sharing dgh.wikispaces.com. I hope everyone comes and has a visit and learns from it. And also teachers kind of can use it as a model for a project idea that they can do in their class. So you guys can find Garth on Twitter. He is at Garth Holman, yeah?
Garth Holman. Yeah,
nice and easy. Awesome. Thanks again for joining us, Garth. Okay.
Oh, wait, let me add one more. Mike is Professor Mike One on Twitter, and Mike couldn't be here today, but his Twitter is at Professor Mike One.
All right, awesome.